Hey everybody, welcome to Geekoholics Anonymous, episode 115. I'm your host Rico, here with my co-host.
What's up dudes, it's Dane Cody.
It's not Mr. Dane Cody this week.
No, just Dane Cody today.
Sup dudes, Michelangelo coming
in. What's up bro?
Dudes bro.
Yeah, dude bros.
Welcome everybody. We get together once a week, talk about video games, TV, movies, and or whatever the hell we like. Usually start the show off with some what you've been playing, get into the news, public service announcements, and our free-for-all. And even before all of that, we get into our designated drinking section. So,
yes.
Dane, what are you drinking?
Tonight, I am drinking Grey Goose vodka in a blackberry ginger ale.
Ooh, that sounds very nice.
You would like it a lot. It's very tasty.
It's funny, we're both sharing drinks with one common ingredient.
Vodka?
No, ginger ale.
Oh.
I got the crown and ginger going.
Nice.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna lie. Whiskey ginger, that is kind of one of my go-to drinks when I'm out and about.
It's a good one.
Usually bourbon, if I can get it, is usually my bourbon and ginger ale. So
I don't own any Grey Goose. I don't think I have any vodka right now.
Always gotta have vodka, man.
Yeah, I might have to fix that party foul soon.
I mean, yeah, it was just kind of, I don't know. People are going to freak out, but like, I don't know. I've probably said it on the show before. Like, I'm not the biggest fan of Grey Goose. It's a wheat vodka and it's fine. It's, I don't know. I use it as a mixing vodka. I don't drink it straight that often, but it's okay. I prefer, like a potato vodka myself. I find that it's smoother and I don't know. I just like it better. But
he reminded me of a story of drinking vodka straight.
Vodka waters, man.
No, not vodka water. This just is
drinking it full on straight.
Oh god,
I sip vodka.
This is a funny story. This is from Jesus. This is from way back in the day. I think I was 16 years old. My buddy O was driving us around in his the Toyota. He always used to borrow his dad's Toyota, and it was a 4x4 stick shift Toyota.
Okay, yeah.
And I had just finished failing my driver's exam. But I hadn't told anyone yet.
Okay.
I was pretty upset and embarrassed. And I don't think I haven't told this story on the show, have I?
Doesn't sound familiar.
Okay. Sorry, peeps. We're going to get the video games and movies and all that shit in a sec. This is just take you down memory lane.
Yeah.
So when I went to get my license, I was like really timid and I don't know, I'm 16. I'm a fucking kid. It's like, I'm driving a car. I could kill myself. I could kill someone else. It seemed like a pretty big responsibility. So I was a little scared of it. Right.
Right.
Anyway, I just fucked up a bunch of shit on my first exam and I failed it. Anyway, a bunch of the guys were going out on the weekend. Like we would do is, we'd have someone would be driving and then the rest of us would like someone would boot for us. Actually, we didn't need anyone to boot for us because Owen, his brothers, he had like two older brothers that were of age and they would steal their brother's ID because they look like him.
Okay,
I don't know if they'd steal it or if they'd borrow it. I think they borrowed it.
I'm sure he got it back.
But here's some 16-year-olds going in the liquor store buying liquor. But what can you do when you look exactly like the person on the ID and it's not a fake ID?
Right.
Not much you can do, but it's like, well, that looks pretty legit. The other kids look pretty young, but I got ID, you know? So anyway, I bought a Mickey of vodka. This is where the vodka reminded me of. And a Silent Sam. Oh, okay. Boy. I was anything but silent that night. I was actually very noisy that night. So back in the day, I don't know what fucking kids do nowadays. I think they just Snapchat genitals to each other and don't leave the house.
Right.
we used to drive around and go to parties. And anyway, as we're leaving the liquor store, we're heading to a party. And so someone else had a Mickey or something, and someone else had something. There was four of us in the car. Of course, driver wasn't drinking. We were idiots, but we weren't total irresponsible, right? We were pretty legit about not being fucking idiots. No one ever drove drunk.
Okay, that's good.
So O is the designated driver, and I can't remember exactly who we were with. I want to say maybe Jude was there, and I'm pretty sure Nathan was there. Anyway,
just pulling these names out.
Yeah, these are all.
There was some friends that were there.
I know. So, I know O and Jude listen to the podcast, so they might. O short for Oscar. They might remember this story better than I do. I know Oscar was there absolutely for certain. And we just started chugging the alcohol straight because we had nothing to mix it with. So here I am, little fucking lightweight. I don't know what I was when I was 16. I think I was like 130.
You're still a lightweight.
Yeah, but I don't weigh 130 pounds.
Okay, and, fair enough.
So I'm chugging Silent Sam vodka. It's literally paint thinner. It's fucking terrible. And we're all chugging. Chugging a Mickey of vodka is not a good idea.
No.
So I'm loopy, like, within minutes. And we go to this party, yada yada, whatever. I'm fucking... Rah, 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 rah. But we get to fucking 7-Eleven. Like, the cops showed up. The party got broken up. And we got 7-Eleven. And then I'm just, like, puking in the parking lot.
Oh.
But, like, not just puking, like, to the side of the vehicle. Like, everyone from the party's there. So it's, like, rad. And then I'm just lying down in the middle of the parking lot screaming out, 55! And everyone's like, what the fuck are you talking about? And I'm like, 55, I failed my driver's license, it's fucking 55 demerits. And I was just a disaster.
Anyway,
your vodka reminded me of that very impactful day of my teenage adolescence life.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Sorry for that tangent.
Oh, that's good stuff.
Yeah, fuck. I never did that again.
I don't imagine you did. You probably woke up the next day feeling pretty crappy.
I've gotten really drunk, but
yeah,
and sick. I've done those things. Try not to do them together, but it happens. But in the middle of a parking lot, laid out ridiculousness in front of a bunch of people. Yeah, that hasn't happened.
Yeah, exactly.
So let's get back on track.
So, what's up, man? Did you have a good weekend?
Yeah.
Anything exciting happen?
Went saw Spiderman.
Nice.
Hung out with the fam damly.
The fam dam family.
Not anything too exciting.
No?
Did you take advantage of any of the crazy Amazon Prime Day deals?
Dude, my weekend was full of cars.
Well, that didn't happen until the Prime Day shit was Monday. Oh, yeah, you went to some car shows, didn't you?
Oh man, I went to like two cars and coffees this weekend, Saturday and Sunday.
Lamborghinis and Alfa Romeos and all that fun
stuff.
Well,
yeah, we went to the one cars and coffee on Saturday morning, looked at Lambos and Ferraris and Porsches.
Is this just a dealership down there does this every weekend or?
No, it's one dealership does cars and coffee down in Spanish Banks, which is like a park kind of in Vancouver here, and it's put on by the Lamborghini Lotus dealership. But of course, like, everybody shows up.
Everyone although, with to an be awesome fair, car.
Yeah, although to be fair, there was a lot of Lambos that showed up this year. Well, to this particular one that we were at anyways. It was a really nice day too, so that helps a lot. If it's a really nice day, there's going to be a lot more cars there. There was Murcielagos, Aventadors, Huracans, Gallardos. Yeah, there was lots of Lambos there. There was all kinds of really cool cars. Some A10 or some, geez, A10s.
A10
there
Warthog.
Was some R8 V10s. Strangely enough, no Lotuses actually this year. There was a couple Lamborghini, like older Lambos. There was a Countach that was there. Couple of Panteras, actually, Di Tommaso Panteras, which were super cool from the 80s. And then after after I finished up there, I decided, fuck it. So I drove over to the Alfa Romeo dealership and proceeded to drool all over a bunch of Alfa Romeos.
Yeah, I saw you and then
took out one of the Giulias for a drive because why the hell not? It was a beautiful day and I wanted to take the 4C out, but
I saw one of those today in traffic, actually.
The freaking sales, one of the sales guys had it out, so I wasn't able to drive it. I was kind of choked, actually.
That's a pretty cool little ride.
Oh, man, it's so cool.
I remember the first time I saw it in the road, I think I texted you. I'm like, what the fuck is this? Because yeah, like, I had no idea what it was.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. It's a super, super cool little car, super lightweight and fast.
So really now you're sad that you drove a nice Alfa Romeo and you're like, oh, back to reality.
Yeah, I mean, it was a nice car. Don't get me wrong. I didn't get to drive the Quadrifoglio, which is the 500 horsepower, $100,000 one.
Yeah, I don't think they're gonna let you drive that without knowing you're potentially a qualified buyer.
To be honest, I actually think if I would have pushed it a little more, I probably could have got him to let me take it out.
Well, did you show up in your Beamer?
Yeah.
Oh, well, yeah. There you go.
So I took out just one of the regular all-wheel drive Giulias. Just one of the... It's got a turbo 4, 280 horsepower. It was a really nice car. I was very impressed. I was very impressed. They didn't have any of the ones that I would prefer to have. If I was to order one, I would prefer it to be rear wheel drive. And there's a few other things that I actually don't want. So I don't know who's ordering these cars. They seem to do a terrible job of ordering, I don't know, the stuff that I would like to have in it. It's got all these like shit that I don't really care about, that I don't really want to pay for. So if I was to actually look at buying one, I would probably have to like order it for me because they don't seem to do a very good job of ordering them for people like me. So, but no, it was really surprising. I took it out for a boot, took it out for a good long while. Actually took it out for probably like a good half an hour, maybe even 45 minute drive. Bombed around in it. It was really nice.
How long it takes impressed. To get around the block in Vancouver?
No, I mean, not quite. The dealership that we were at is actually out in Maple Ridge, so not Uh-oh. Quite too bad. So we were actually able to get on some roads and, you know, take it on some twisty stuff and get a feel for like what the car actually feels like. So yeah, no, it was cool. It was a lot of fun. If I was honestly in the market for buying like a new car in that category, I would be very hard pressed to not at least cross shop it. I would at least be driving it alongside like the new Jag XE and the new Beamers and stuff. So I don't know, if I was in that market, I would be very hard pressed not to at least look hard at it. It would be very tempting for me because I love the way it drove. I actually think I like the way it drove better than the recent Beamers that I've driven, the newer ones, I mean. Yeah, I don't know. It would be hard. So that was a lot of fun. And then Sunday, the Porsche dealership in Langley they do a Cars and Coffee the first weekend, the first Sunday of the month normally. But because last week was a holiday and stuff, they postponed it till this week. So we went to that on Sunday, looked at a ton of gorgeous Porsches and all the other gorgeous things that came out there as well. That was where I saw the Lamborghini Aventador SV or the Super Veloce came out, and a couple Ferraris and a McLaren, and yeah, it was pretty sweet. Super cool.
Was that when you saw that gray and blue Lambo?
It was like the blue and the baby blue one with the
I saw that and I'm like, oh man.
Yeah, that one was, it was cool. I was actually chatting with the guy's wife that owned it. It was pretty funny. Apparently he owns a McLaren as well, and she was saying
that guy's doing pretty shitty in life.
I know, hey. She was like, yeah, it's okay. I like his McLaren better, though. The Lambo's not really my style. And I was like, yeah, okay. Well, you know.
Can I strangle you now?
But yeah, no, there's some really cool cars. Some gorgeous M3s, actually, that were there. Also, a guy showed up in a rough Turbo R, which is just, oh, man, so pretty. Yeah, no, there was some cool stuff. So
sounds like you had a fun weekend.
Yeah, man, it was
mine wasn't too exciting besides seeing Spider-Man.
Oh yeah, and then I saw Transformers. So
so back to the Prime Day deal.
Yeah, did you buy some shit?
I bought a couple things, but actually,
what'd you buy out of curiosity?
On Monday night,
I kind of looked through a bit and didn't really
night,
see anything.
I was freaking that at Wario64 on Twitter, which I think some of you guys have started following because I told you he's freaking amazing with posting shit.
Yeah, most
internet.
Of his stuff is American deals, though, so for me, they don't usually...
Well, I have people I ship stuff to, and then they ship it to me, but they had a bunch of price errors on games, like, so you're getting, like, the Prime discount plus something else, so stuff that was, like, on sale for, like, $30 or $40 in your
like
carts.
$5?
When you went to go check out, was like $5, $6, $10, $12, like ridiculous numbers. So I tried getting Crash Bandicoot, but by the time I jumped on that, they either ran out of stock or they fixed it. It was like $12 or something, plus or minus.
Oh, wow.
I'm like, God damn it. I actually would have played that game for that much money. I don't really want to pay any more for that because I have the original three PlayStation games in my freaking other room.
Right.
So anyway, I was kind of interested in that. I missed that. And then everybody's golf was like $11 or $12, and that one didn't seem to work for me. And then there was a bunch of shit that was working, but I was like, nah, do I really want World of Final Fantasy on PS4? I'm not gonna play it. It was like $6 or something stupid.
Wow.
A couple like 3DS game, like it was tons of shit, but apparently it wasn't just restricted to games because Wario complained. He's like, I feel like we missed out on some really good TV deals focusing on video games, because I saw people reply to him later on after all the errors and stuff got fixed. Like, I think people got Lego sets like for insanely cheap.
Wow.
A bunch of people got like a bunch of the video game Nenoroid or Ninoroid figures really cheap for like super cheap, like $10 or $12, and those are like $50 to $60.
Oh wow.
So like insane. Like, I don't know if
one thing on the day that I wrestled with hard.
Let me guess.
And that was the Oculus.
I was gonna say I wrestled really hard with that as well.
Like I was at the office and I was talking about it with like my coworkers, and I was like, fuck, that is like $260 off plus $100 Amazon gift card. That's like you're getting the Oculus plus the touch controllers for like $450.
Yeah, that's an insane deal. Even after conversion, it's an insanely good deal.
Dude, that was on the Canadian site.
For $400? No.
It was $550 plus $100 Amazon gift card on the Canadian site.
If I saw
that's
that
why
Canadian.
I was wrestling with it. I was like, it was the headset and the two touch controllers. It
I
didn't
saw
include
it on the
sensor.
US site, and I was like, really?
That was what I was struggling with, and I was like, man, if I had a PC that could run this, I would fucking buy this right now.
It's in stock on the Canadian site right now.
So
not with the $100 gift card.
So yeah, I mean, even without that, it's still a smoking deal. $550 is a great deal.
Yeah, they were
that.
Asking $699 before, weren't they?
Yeah, and that didn't include the touch controllers. That was
$699
for the headset.
Yes,
that's $550 plus the touch controllers.
Yeah, it's actually in stock right now.
So yeah,
if I had the $100 gift card. If I had the $100 gift card, I'd be like clicking the button. Maybe I don't know. Like, is this? And then I saw that deal and I'm like, holy crap! I really honestly thought about that too. And then I was like, hey, is this a good or a bad thing? Is this an indicator that they're not moving Oculus units or that a new one's around the corner? But Oculus has been pretty goddamn quiet lately. Like, they weren't at E3. The whole kerfuffle with Palmer Luckey and the trial and all that negative press. It's like they've kind of been like lurking. Like, Oculus just seems like they don't even exist right now.
They're definitely in a weird spot.
So that also entered my mind too when I was looking at those prices. I'm like, And then I remembered they have their stupid Oculus store. It's not as open as the Vive, but man, that price is pretty goddamn good.
Yeah, I know.
And the touch controllers are better than the Vive controllers.
Yeah, I don't know about better, but they're at least on par. That's the thing, right?
Everyone says they're better. I haven't got to use them, but people say they're better.
Yeah, that's the thing with the headset and the controllers and everything. If you go that route, you're getting something that is essentially on par with the HTC Vive, maybe even a little bit better. But yeah, I don't know. Like, it is really a big question. Like, I don't think that Oculus is going anywhere. I mean, they're owned by Facebook, so they got all that Facebook money. So, I mean, I don't think they're going to...
That internet money.
Yeah, I don't think that they're going to be disappearing anytime soon. So, you know, like, one of the guys in my office was like, oh, that or they're just selling it because they're going out of business. And I'm like, you do realize they're owned by Facebook, right? Yeah, they're not going out of business. Like, so, I don't know. It's a really good deal. And I think they got a great headset and stuff. And for that price, I think it's, I mean, that's on par with the PSVR.
Really? And it is. I think that might be headset. Cheaper than the PSVR.
Yeah.
Or no, the PSVR was it $549 with nothing?
I don't know. I bought the like.
Set you bought the bundle
with everything.
I bought the bundle. I can't even remember.
Jeez, God damn it! Talk about first.
I didn't realize
problems.
That deal was on the Canadian site. I was looking on the American site.
Yeah, no, man. I was on the Canadian site because a bunch of the guys at the office were looking at the American one, and I'm like, man, I don't want to have to fucking ship that stuff and deal with all that. So then I switched over to the Canadian site, and I was like looking through, and I was like, man, that Oculus deal is like, that is tempting.
I did buy, the Vive right now on Amazon is $1,149.
Yep,
like more than double the price.
Yep, and I don't think it's double as good.
No, absolutely not. The difference between the Oculus and the Vive is negligible.
Yeah.
When the Vive was out with when the Oculus didn't have the touch controllers, the Vive beat it hands down. But with the controllers, they're
neck and neck.
Yeah. And the Rift is like light, wasn't it? Lighter and more comfortable.
The Rift is a little lighter, not by much, but it is a little bit lighter. The screens, I think, they're like almost identical on both of them.
God damn it.
I know.
No, like not I said, buying man, an Oculus. Not buying
like
an Oculus.
It's $270 off.
I'm not buying an Oculus.
It's a really good deal.
I'm not buying an Oculus. Considering I haven't played my PlayStation VR in a while, I probably shouldn't buy an Oculus.
Like I said, if I didn't need to essentially rebuild my whole computer in order to run VR on PC, I would have bought it.
Did get a 3DS game for $6.
Ooh.
Miitopia. I don't know why I bought it. It was
because it was $6.
It was $6. And then I bought that wireless 8-bit dough or whatever the hell you call it. NES Classic wireless receiver.
Oh, right. Yep.
It was like $11 compared to $30 or something or $20.
I should have actually checked to see if any of those.
Because that works, that basically adds Bluetooth to your NES Classic, so you can actually sync a PS4 control, like any wired Bluetooth controller.
Yeah, if I would have thought about it, I should have checked to see if any of those Miidomo Bluetooth controllers were on sale, because I would have liked to actually grab one of those.
Yeah, I got
there's definitely
one.
Some
I
stuff on my
on
phone
sale.
Every once in a while that I'm like, man, I should just...
So there were some good deals. It wasn't like, oh my god, it never is. Oh my god, it's a lot of hype. That's for sure.
Yeah.
With that, I guess we can get into what you've been playing. I don't really have much to say except for I got a hilarious PUBG story. I'm still playing Fire Emblem. The difficulty has kind of, I'm in act three. There's apparently five acts. And I don't know how I got into some, I was in some forums. It is Fire Emblem Echoes on 3DS, for those of you who aren't aware of which one specifically, considering there's like 50 Fire Emblems on 3DS now.
Yeah, they're just getting a lot, that's for sure.
I don't know why I was on, where was I? I think I was on Reddit. I don't know how I got where I was. No one can explain how I do things in my life. But I was somewhere and people were complaining about, oh, the problem with this game is, oh, I was on NeoGAF.
Okay. Okay.
And people were complaining how Fire Emblem Echoes is apparently like a pay to win. The DLC is basically how you have to beat the fourth and fifth chapters because the difficulty ratchets up so much that there's like essentially really good grinding slash item levels in the DLC, in the paid DLC. That make the fourth and fifth chapters so much more bearable because apparently it gets ridiculously hard. And I think I may have actually gotten to my first mission that I lost, and that was in the third chapter. And I don't think I've ever lost a mission in a Fire Emblem game.
Wow.
Yeah. And I'm like, and it took a really long time. It was like a lot of enemy units versus mine. And there was some stupid enemy that kept respawning enemies. Which is really annoying.
Yeah.
Anyway, I really hope it doesn't get that difficult, because if it does get ridiculous, I don't have time to fucking grind in that game.
Yeah, that's...
Especially with Splatoon coming out and stuff. Like, I'm just playing this right now, because it's my mobile game, and I'm kind of played the shit out of Mario Kart 8, and I played the shit out of Zelda. I didn't buy the Zelda DLC, so it's just what I have on rotation for my handheld system at the moment.
Right.
So yeah, hopefully that doesn't come to fruition, that it gets really hard, but I don't know. After the last mission I played, it might be true.
I hate it when they do that.
And then, like I said last week, I have a problem. Like, I can't stop playing PUBG.
PUBG.
Like, I launched Persona 5 and I'm like, oh, I just could play. I'm playing PUBG all of a sudden. I'm jumping out of the fucking plane.
You would.
I just don't. That game is so addicting, man. And it still gets the heart fucking racing like nothing. It's really, it's stupid. It's so dumb. But I do have a pretty I think it's a hilarious story. My wife is like, why are you telling me this? Like, just rolling her eyes like, I don't care. I
do not care.
But I'm like, I have to tell you.
I gotta tell somebody.
I was playing duos with my brother-in-law.
Okay.
And we've been, like I said, the best way to play this game is playing aggressively, because you get better. Like, I'm better at killing people than I was before. Like, when I won my chicken dinner, I killed four people solo. I did pretty good. But man, in a gunfight, I'm much more confident now, because I've been playing so much more aggressive. But we were playing duos, and we usually, you know, we're in the plane, we're chatting. We use Discord to chat. That Discord's awesome. I think it's the best chat app on PC.
There's so many fucking chat apps on PC.
I know, but it's good because it's basically like TeamSpeak. You can create rooms. You don't have to pay for a server. The sound quality is amazing. You can create multiple rooms, multiple chats, and it's all freaking free. And you can text chat and post links and do all that stuff. And it's a really slick interface. There's a freaking mobile app on the phone. It's Discord is shit. If you're on the fence about using Discord, it's awesome. Like, we don't
even fence about it. It's just, I've got TeamSpeak and
I fuck that shit. That all needs someone you need to know.
So many other.
Oh yeah. TeamSpeak, I think I've got like Ventrilo. Six different ones
right now. Yeah. I've got like Ventrilo, TeamSpeak, obviously the Steam chat. Then I've got in-game other stuff. I've also got the Razer comms, which I've used before.
Discord just roll all of those into one, make it look nice and sound good and work, and that's Discord. So just uninstall the rest of that shit. Just telling you now. Anyway, so we're chatting on Discord. We're in the plane. We're trying to make our plans. Like, oh, where are we going to jump out? We have some favorite like places already, because we played a few times that we like going to.
Right.
And it's like, just depends on where the plane path was. And it's like, okay, let's go to these buildings near the beach. Just a group of four buildings. He goes and checks out 2 and I go check out 2, and we kind of divvy the loot that way. We're not like on top of each other, because at the start no one has guns, so we don't need to be like running together. But anyway,
when
we're parachuting.
When you jump out of the planes, do you aim for the bushes?
What?
When you jump out of the plane, do you aim for the bushes?
No, I don't get it. You're making a joke, but that went over my head.
The other guys, you think of what I'm thinking? Aim for the bushes.
I don't know what that's from.
What? It's from The Other Guys. The Other Guys. That was The Rock and Samuel L. Jackson at the beginning of the movie. Just standing on top of the building, chasing the bad guys.
I've seen that movie, but I don't remember that.
That's like right near the beginning. It's like the best part.
I gotta go on the internet
now.
Oh,
man.
No, but speaking of fucking bushes.
For you, of all people, you'd get that shit.
Speaking of bushes, fucking some of the little bushes in this stupid game while you're driving along look like fucking people. And sometimes, like, oh, I saw some. Oh, no, it's a fucking bush. So we're parachuting into these houses, and we notice one guy's there in between two of us. It's like, what? This one guy, really? Like, this is duos. Where is your fucking teammate? Clearly, you guys parachuted far away from each other, or your buddy wasn't paying attention or something.
Okay.
So we proceed to punch the shit out of him. We just don't even bother going in the houses. We're just like chasing him down and punching him. And he's down. I think he hit me once. I don't think he even hit Trevor. I got the final blow, because when you play duos, it's a little different than solo. When you die in solo, you die. Have I talked about this in duos or squad? You go into a down state, kind of like in Gears of War, where you're crawling along and your teammates can revive you.
Right.
And they revive you with very little health if they do. Anyway, this guy's crawling around, and seriously, I think I punched him like 20 times. When he's in the down state, I think it seriously took like 20 more punches to the head to actually kill him.
Right, okay.
So anyway, we're going through the houses. We're fucking grabbing some shit. I get a gun, a UMP. I think Trevor got like a handgun or an Uzi, really had nothing. And we're like, okay, we need to go get some more shit. And let's go to this next grouping of buildings down the road a little bit. So we're heading towards there, and then we hear a car, like a dune buggy. And I'm like, I had a sight, so I was zoomed in, and I could see, oh, there's two guys. Oh, they got out. They went into that building. And I'm like, okay, let's. And Trevor's like, let's go get them. I'm like, no, let's go steal their car, because that's way funnier. Because then they're fucked. They don't got a car, and we could just go somewhere else.
Right.
Leave in my head, this played out way better in my head than it should have.
Of course. It always does.
So they're inside the building, and then we're like sneaking by. And we didn't really fight them, because Trev didn't have a very good gun, and I just figured we would have been outgunned, so let's steal their car and go somewhere else, right?
Right.
We jump in the car. Obviously, it's a buggy, dune buggy, so it's super loud. So they are immediately outside of the building shooting at us as I'm driving away. Trevor gets downed, and I'm like, ah, fuck. Okay, well, I may as well go back and get killed, so we can start another match, right? So okay. I pull a Yui. I head back towards the guys, and for whatever reason, one of the guys is just standing in the middle of the field. So I fucking sideswipe him and basically just hit him with the rear end of the car, and he's dead. Well, he's not dead. He's downed. His buddy is in, like, behind the wall or something. I don't know what he's doing, but he wasn't helping his teammate try and shoot me in the car. So anyway, I fishtail this guy, essentially hit him with the rear end of my car. So now he's behind me on the ground, downed. So,
Did you run him over?
I put in reverse. I fucking run him over. I finished the job. I get out of the car. His buddy's coming around the corner. I kill his buddy. So I just killed the two guys.
Nice.
And
you stole their car.
And Trev's watching in spectator mode, and he's talking to me. And he's like, that was fucking amazing. I'm like, that was probably the most amazing kill. I took out two guys all by myself. So I loot their shit, jump in the car, and I'm like, okay, well, I'm going to go find another fight, because I want to die quickly.
Right, so that we can go
load
play
another game, right? Because
thing together.
He's just spectating. Like, so I'm out looking for a fight. I cruise down the road a little bit. I see a car. I'm like, well, I need to grab a new car, because my car is fucked, because it got shot a bunch. And you can explode. You can blow up cars. So if guys keep shooting cars, you can essentially get killed in your car, right?
Do they light on fire and kind of do the classic, like, my car is starting to look real rough, and then it blows up?
And then they explode. Yeah. You can actually even shoot the tires out and stuff, which affect the driving physics.
Oh, nice.
Okay. Not many people really do that, but I noticed the tires can get blown out because I've driven with cars with front wheels blown out, and it's just like steering goes to hell. So I jump out, I get in this car, and I just hear these shots coming out. I'm like, oh shit, I hit the deck. Luckily, there's like a, you know, like the median or the dividers, like on the highway, that concrete,
yep,
2 or 3 foot high, like wall.
Yeah.
There's just a short row of that shit. So I'm on the ground, prone on the ground, and I rotate the camera like, oh fuck, there's two guys. I'm like, okay, well, let's fight these guys. So I pop up, take a couple shots. I swear I hit one of them in the head, but I see blood flying off of my, I'm just going back and forth, pop, 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 back and forth between the two of them. Mm-hmm. And I hit the ground again, and Trev's like, do I have like a grenade? And I'm like, no, but I got a stun grenade. So I throw a stun grenade over, they were behind like just a wall across the street essentially from me. So I go and throw a stun grenade, and then I just like, Leroy Jenkins, I just go running towards them. Meanwhile, I see the one guy's like prone on the ground, doesn't know up from down, and I can just tell he got the stun grenade because he's just moving all erratically, like he can't see anything. So I just unload on him, and I'm like, where the fuck did his teammate go? Front door opens up, buddy comes out the front door of the house, it was right there, misses me with a shotgun.
Ooh.
So he could have killed me, but it's just like he missed me, and I'm like, brah, killed him. Killed two guys. I'm like, this is awesome. I'm on a tear. I'm invincible. Go back.
Screw trying to run out and die quickly.
And I'm trying to die quickly. Like, I'm picking fights. Like, and every fight at this point is 2 versus 1 because it's like I lost my teammate, right? So I'm feeling fucking awesome.
Right.
So I go back, jump in the new car that was across the street. And as I'm jumping in the car, this Jeep goes whizzing by, and I see two fucking guys, and I'm like, well, I'm going to go pick a fight with those guys. So I chase them down in the car. Like, we're going down the road, and then we go off-road because they're like, I guess they're probably discussing, what do we do? Is this fucking guy chasing us? Do we get out and fight him or whatever? I'm just totally on their ass. And then next scene, we're in the off-road, and there's like a big hill, and they just go like straight up in the air into a tree and then start doing crazy physics up in the tree. And I'm like, oh, these guys are so dead. So I'm waiting for them to come back. Like, they're in the air. So I'm like slowing down and just in my panic excitement to kill these guys because I knew they were fucked because when they hit the ground, they were going to take a bunch of damage if it didn't kill them. I jumped out of my car before it stopped and it ran over me and killed me. I'm like, God damn it. I would have killed both those guys. It was like on a tear. And then that's the problem with this game is like, if you get out of your car while it's moving, it is
get out of the way.
No, there's no getting out of the way because you don't get out in front of your car. But it's like, I think you just take speed damage from hitting the ground at a fast speed. Oh,
you're moving too quickly?
Yeah. So I think the physics is just a little weird. I understand you take damage getting, like, how many games do you play? Excuse me. I just burped there. With a vehicle where you get out and, you know, you might take a tiny bit of damage, but you could usually jump out of cars while they're moving, right?
It depends on how fast you're going.
It depends. Right? I wasn't going that fast, but I forgot. You have to fucking stop. You can't get out of a moving vehicle in this game because for whatever reason, it always seems to fucking kill you.
Right.
So, yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
My sister-in-law thought that story was funny.
It's pretty awesome, the fact that you're
so
on.
So then I went to go review my recording, and my stupid shadow play on NVIDIA didn't record it. And I'm like, God damn it, that was an amazing couple clips.
Had you not had, like, turned your shadow play on or something? Or?
No, it's on, but for whatever reason, I swear I hit F9 at the start of our play session to start recording, and for whatever reason, it just didn't record that. And I'm like, God damn it. Like, that was like a couple really awesome gif worthy fucking tweets right there. Especially the fucking when I sideswiped and killed the one guy and then backed over him and then killed his teammate. It was right. An amazing play. It was awesome.
Well, fair enough. Glad to see that you're still playing the PUBG.
Yeah. And then obviously I played some more games and I'm doing all right at that game.
Fair enough, man.
It's a good game, man. It's fun.
No more chicken dinners, though?
No, just a few more top 10 finishes.
Okay.
I think the problem I have now with being too aggressive is that at the end, you got to dial it back a bit because everyone's right. fucking gone prone in small open spaces and using the environment to kind of hide.
Right. Yeah, so that makes sense.
Being aggressive doesn't work with going prone crazy at the end. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Man, what a good game.
Well, I mean, in a way, there's some meta, right? At the beginning, it's a little bit like a MOBA. At the beginning, you have to play it kind of differently than the mid game, and then the end game has a very different sort yeah, of play.
Yeah, no, absolutely. The end game, right? You do have to get more defensive.
So, I mean, it's not... Oh, excuse me. It's not entirely like a...
It's not Call of Duty the whole time, right? It's like multiple games. Like, there's the cooldown... heal phase, regroup, re-equip, you know, and then it's no wonder that game's doing so well, because it just taps this energy, and I don't know, I haven't been addicted like this to a game in a long time. The only thing that sucks is I wish there was a better progression or unlock system. Because that would be cool. Like, it seems like every week they have a weekly reset. You get these crates when you play the game. There's a currency you get for viewers. You've seen the winning screens from me and other people posted on the internet, right?
Yep.
There's some fake stupid currency that you earn from kills and wins and whatever. Depending on how far you get, the more you get, right?
Right.
So there's these crates that have cosmetics. And you get one, like, I think the first crate's like 700, and then it's 1400, and then 2800, and then 30.
Okay, so they kind of get more and more expensive.
They just get more and more expensive. And then I think it's every, I don't know if it's every Sunday or every Monday, it resets. So then it's again 700, and then 1400. So it doesn't just keep getting more, it just gets more expensive if you're playing the game a lot, right?
Right.
So. You know,
that makes sense.
Yeah,
that's
which is cool. So it's not like you hit a point and it's always 4,000 and you're not getting them very often. It's like Monday rolls around, you usually have enough currency to buy another 3 crates, right? And it's just strictly cosmetic stuff. So I was looking in the marketplace on Steam, just a tip for anyone out there playing PUBG, I would not get too attached to some of the cosmetics in that game, because a few of them are going for a pretty penny.
Really?
Yeah. The trench coat, for example. Like, you can...
I've heard about this, actually.
You find all these cosmetic items in the world. They randomly spawn, so you can change how you look while you're playing. But if you unlock an item in a crate, like, say, sunglasses, or the trench coat, or bandana, or whatever, you could look like that every time you start a match, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah.
A couple items are really expensive. Trench coat, for example, last I saw was going for $300, mid-300s, US, Steam.
Like real dollars?
Yeah, real dollars on the marketplace.
Totally. Jesus.
Yeah,
really?
So if you get a trench coat, sell that shit, and then you have your, like, Steam currency to buy games on your PC for the next freaking season or two. Easily.
Jeepers.
The bandana was 300 and something.
That's like, insane.
I haven't obviously.
Are people honestly that stupid?
Man, this is the internet. you don't have to answer that question. You know. It's Steam.
What the hell?
It's like Dota items are apparently crazy like that too. And Counter-Strike gun skins and shit. But I've never really been in, played games where I look or even care about that. I just happen to be looking because I'm like, oh man, I should check out. I really like the trench coat. It looked badass when you start with it. And I'm like, Steam Marketplace thing, and it's going to be like 25 cents or something stupid. And I'm like, what the? I'm like, oh, I know what I'm doing when I get it, unlock a trench coat one day. Hopefully.
Wow.
Because I'm selling that shit.
That's insane.
The most expensive item is going for like $1,100. And you can't earn this one. It was basically a crate that was given to people who played this game before it was even in early access.
Wow.
So, like, I guess friends of friends and beta testers of PlayerUnknown. It's the PlayerUnknown set. And it's basically, oh, I think it's just the outfit that, you know, that white shirt, tie, and I don't know. I don't know what it even looks like. But anyway, it's going for $1,100. Like, holy crap.
That's crazy.
People are buying the Twitch, you know, the free Twitch Prime freaking outfit that they gave away for this game. People are buying that for $40.
What? I don't even own the game. So you're saying that if I own the game, I could log in and then sell that free crate?
That's the one thing. You won't be able to sell the stuff you get for free. Apparently, I don't know how you get a crate, but people have gotten crates with the whole set.
And the crate
is selling for 40 plus or minus.
Wow.
The individual items, you can buy them all for, I think someone was saying like $5 or $10. So you could sell it, the stuff you got for free. Anyway, I thought it was crazy. Just opened up my eyes to the marketplace, of the Steam marketplace. I'm like, oh yeah, this place is crazy fucking Wild West. I forgot about this.
It's just, wow. Yeah.
I know. So I'm hoping I get one of those items one day and it's like, yeah.
Huh. That's, yeah, wow.
So yeah, if you play that game and you have one of those items, you should sell it.
Well, I mean, I'm an Amazon Prime member, so I mean, I don't own the game, but I could, in theory, log in and get that stuff.
Yeah, I don't think that stuff's worth very much. But if you play the game and you get the trench coat or the bandana man, sell that shit. It's stupid.
Apparently.
It's stupid cosmetics. Just get rid of that shit. Yeah. It's $300. That's at least, what, 6 games or more, depending on if you're Steam sale or what you're doing?
Oh, yeah. It's yeah.
That's
well, like, that's the thing. So I was looking at, like, Destiny 2 on PC. There's the pre-order right now. You can buy the base game, or you can buy the base game plus expansions.
But does it show up in the Battle or Blizzard launcher now?
Yeah.
Oh, I haven't launched that in a while, so.
Yeah. No, you can go to the Blizzard store and pre-order it there. And then the other one is their limited digital deluxe version, which comes with
season pass and all the bullshit.
Which comes with the season's pass, the regular game, and then it comes with a bunch of in-game bullshit. BS. And I'm like, do I really want to spend $100 on that? Like, is it really worth it? Well, it's $100 American. As far as I'm aware, the prices that I was looking at earlier were in American dollars.
So I was looking
$59 USD.
Yeah. So, I don't have that launcher on my...
Oh, it's just on the, like, Blizzard store. Even if you were to just go on their website now, if you go to, like, battle.net, click on the store, it shows the prices and stuff for Destiny. So, but yeah, no, I was kind of surprised, and I was thinking to myself, like, do I really care about some cosmetic shit that everybody who bought the digital deluxe version are also gonna have? Like, it's not like there's anything really, I don't know, it's just, I guess it's slightly different than what other people are rocking, but yeah, so it's $89.99 is the game plus the expansion pass bundle. This is US dollars. Or $99.99 for the digital deluxe edition, which comes with Destiny, the expansion pass, and that it includes a legendary sword, legendary player emote, and a Cabal Empire themed emblem. Now, is that worth $10?
That seems expensive.
Yeah.
So that one doesn't. That's, yeah, so that's not the season pass.
It's the expansion pass.
Oh, well, that's the season pass, I think.
That's the Canadian get access to expansion then, 1 and expansion 2.
Yeah, so that's like the season pass. I think I was looking on the PlayStation Store, PSN, and it was 120. I want to say 119. Because I was pondering getting it digitally. Because I have it.
Right.
I just have pre-orders on physical right now.
Yep.
But problem is there's never deals on the stupid stores on digital new shit. You just get screwed.
Yep.
Well, you played more Secret World Legends?
Yep.
We don't have to talk about that, do we?
No, I mean, it's it's what I've been playing. That game is great.
I'm bringing
it's
really balls. Sucking. If you want to talk about it, talk about
it. No, like, to be fair, there isn't, I mean, I'm still, it's like I mentioned before, I'm still playing through the stuff that I've already played a couple of times.
So you're not, like, near end game or any crazy new content?
No, not yet, no.
How many hours would you say you've played?
I don't even know, to be honest with you. I don't know, 15 maybe? I don't know, I'll have to check.
Yeah, that's not very much probably, for an MMO/RPG.
No, I'll probably be pushing. I'm getting closer to where I'm getting into some new stuff. To be fair, I forgot how like difficult some of the stupid quests are. As far as like just having to figure them out, but. But it's good. It's great. I really like it a lot. And it's, you know, I've thought about it a bit more, and I honestly think that that game might have one of the coolest video game universes in a very, very long time. Easily the coolest universe. Well, I don't want to say like easily the coolest universe in an MMO, but definitely in the top three coolest universes in an MMO. I think the Guild Wars universe and I think the World of Warcraft universe is pretty cool too. But that's, I think, the big thing that sets it apart is that it's you're playing stuff that you've never played before and it's so unique. And that mixed in with some of the really, really unique quests like I was talking about where you're not just doing a fetch quest or doing a regular MMO type quest, but you're actually having to use your brain and try and figure out like what the developers were helping you to try and do. It's super cool. That stuff really, really can get your brain going in good ways. Like some of those puzzles are super unique in, it just really, yeah, it's cool. It's really cool. We're just, like I said, we're just starting to get to some of the stuff more closer to some of the stuff that I haven't experienced before. So I'll be curious to kind of see if this kind of, so far I've been doing pretty much just solo play. I'm just cruising through. I'm getting close to level 20 now. So I think I'm at level 18 or something like that, somewhere in there. So
I guess you don't have any idea how many people are playing this game, do you?
I don't actually. I've kind of been curious to reach out to Funcom and find out like how, like if this has, if they're seeing a resurgence or if, well, kind of what the deal is, to be honest with you. Just cause like I seem like I'm obviously in still fairly close to kind of the starter area, if you will. And I mean, I still see some people running around and whatnot, but I actually think that game is better when you don't see a ton of people everywhere, because it kind of doesn't, I think when you see too many people running around in that game, it almost sort of breaks part of the magic, because it's supposed to be kind of creepy and you're in these weird, almost, it kind of reminds me almost a little bit of like Stranger Things in some ways.
You just reminded me that that's,
yeah, that's
the release date for that has been announced.
Season 2 got a new trailer today.
October 27th or something?
Yeah.
The same day that the new Assassin's Creed comes out, Mario Odyssey comes out, something else comes out. Apparently it's just like a crazy day, October 27th.
Yeah, that's insane. So yeah, no, like I said, I'm going to keep playing it and I've been really enjoying it. It's been kind of a cool change from a lot of the other stuff that I've been playing. I know it's kind of obviously a big open world, but it's just such a different thing that it's been kind of refreshing. So, and just such a different universe than high fantasy and, you know, that kind of stuff. So yeah, I'm going to probably keep playing it for a bit. I hadn't really played, I played a little bit of Overwatch, but nothing like that was exciting or new had been happening in Overwatch recently. I didn't play the new character or anything yet, so, because he's not out on the regular servers as far as I'm aware. So that's kind of all I've been playing.
Cool. Yeah.
Drove lots of real world cars, and
my addiction has been stupid PUBG. I really want to get back to Persona. I feel like I have to finish it over the next 2 months, or else I'm just going to get screwed this fall.
Because you're not going to finish it.
Because once Destiny comes out,
you're
going to
move away from it, man.
Yeah, and I'm in that last dungeon.
It's kind of the worst spot to stop.
It is the worst spot. Like, I remember
now every time you go to play it, you remember where you are, and you're like, oh yeah.
I remember the last thing I did was have a big boss battle and then start the next dungeon. And it's like, and I needed to talk to certain guys. So it's like, I feel like it's one of those parts where it's like, oh crap, I might have to look up a stupid fact
guide and make sure you don't like F it up.
Yeah. So with that, I guess we can get into the news. This just in.
Limited. Not a ton of news this week. We're still kind of coming off of the
news sucks.
The E3. Yeah, exactly.
I really had to scrape the barrel to find stuff and tell you guys ridiculous drinking stories to help fill time.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
What?
I'm drunk. Limited edition Destiny 2 Glacier White PS4 Pro.
I hate that I want that real bad.
Yeah. I was excited, and then I was not excited. I got really excited when I saw the limited edition Destiny 2 PS4 Pro. But
yeah.
And then I was like, oh, it's just a white PS4 Pro, which is cool.
That comes with Destiny.
It comes with Destiny and the Season Pass and all the shit that the more expensive version. So that's a pretty good deal, because essentially you're saving like 60 or 70 bucks.
Yeah.
If you didn't already have it's a PS4.
$550 Canadian.
So it's $550 as opposed to if you were to buy it for like piecemeal, like $499 for a Pro and $120 for the game. It's $449 or $450 American for this bundle. So you save some money buying Destiny 2 on PS4 if you're planning on to play it on PS4. Not a bad deal, but if you already have a PS4 Pro like I do, it kind of sucks. But
I've been toying with the idea of buying another PlayStation 4 so that I can actually play PlayStation 4 games.
Oh yeah, because your wifey stole the other one.
Dude, she is trucking along in Stardew Valley.
Like, I don't even want to know. I remember last time you were saying all kinds
she's
of crazy
shit. Like, she's almost finished year 5.
Jeez Louise.
She's almost finished all of the trophies that she can get on her single playthrough.
Wow.
Like there's some of the trophies. Some of the trophies you can only get if you do
a second playthrough.
If you were to do a second playthrough, like, for example, you have to join the Joja club and stuff. So it's like you would essentially have to play through it a second time and do the Joja club member stuff. So there's, I think, 2 trophies that are attached to that. But she is so close to finishing all of the other ones without... I mean, we're getting very close.
That's funny.
We're talking she has got almost... 10 star friend level with almost everybody in the town.
Jesus
now.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, yeah, no. She's
I don't
like,
think
we're
I
talking...
had a 10 star with a single person in that game. Yeah. I haven't played it in a while. I remember we were playing that like crazy, and then I dropped it cold turkey.
I kind of had to stop because it's so addicting.
I'll probably, to be honest, start playing that game again when it comes out on Switch.
Yeah. Yeah, I could see that.
Because that would be a pretty sweet mobile game.
Yeah, especially for you with the baby and stuff, and you could kind of meander around and be kind of perfect for stuff like that.
So, back on track, the disappointment part is I was expecting it to look cool with like a cool design or logo or something on it. And like, it's awesome because...
But instead, it's just white?
Have you ever seen a white PS4?
They look rad.
Yeah, they look rad. They're super sharp looking. They're a nice looking console.
Kind of bummed that I don't have one. But I mean, it is just a white PS4, but still.
I see them every once in a while.
They look so good.
At people's houses when I'm working in people's houses. And I'm like, oh, man, that looks pretty cool.
It's like my white Vita. It's so sweet, man. I love my white limited edition.
Every time I see your stupid white Vita when we're at PAX, I'm like, fuck, that looks awesome.
I know.
So much better than the black one.
I know. So it kind of makes me really bad.
Ignore that.
Get your mind out of the gutter.
It's not really a gutter. It's just a fucking asshole.
Ooh. Anyways, moving on.
Even worse.
Way to go, Rick.
White PS4 Off Pro, man. Tracks. It looks cool. God, yes, it does. Okay, next story.
So fan made Mega Man game will let you create your own levels. AKA it's Mega Maker.
Yeah, Mega Man Maker. So this actually isn't out. These guys, I think, released a trailer and some pics.
How long do you think till Capcom shuts this down?
That's the thing. Capcom doesn't normally shut this shit down. So people are split because if you remember, I want to say a few years ago, potentially almost 5 years ago, because Street Fighter is almost its 30th anniversary and Mega Man.
Right.
For the 25th anniversary of both games, if you remember, they did that Mega Man versus Street Fighter 2D game. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I think I remember that.
That was a fan thing. And Capcom's like, that's awesome. We want to get on board and help you with it.
Hmm.
So people are, unless Capcom happens to be making this themselves, which, you know, after seeing Mario Maker, who knows? You wouldn't be.
Interesting. So I'm just kind of glancing through this. And I think what actually might save this is the fact that they're offering to give the game away for free.
Yeah, it's free. They're not selling it. But the thing is no.
So they have a Patreon going, which essentially covers server costs.
Yeah.
So they're trying to get a $15 a month goal to cover the server costs and stuff moving forward. That's cool.
It looks interesting. I imagine this might actually come out, unless Capcom actually happens to be making their own, which, you know what, after Mario Maker success, it wouldn't be too surprising. This seems like a no-brainer for these classic games. The Mega Man Maker, a Metroid Maker, a Castlevania Maker. Like, man, this just seems like just a license to print money.
I feel like the Mega Man thing kind of works a little better for it, but I don't know about a Castlevania Maker necessarily, but yeah.
You're wrong.
Because because Metroid was kind of one big open thing.
It might be harder to do Metroid and Castlevania because, yes, it is a big world as opposed to a clear-cut stage with a start, mini boss, and end.
Yeah.
Looks cool.
Hey, did you get a chance to check out the Mario Kart VR that Nintendo is working on?
Yeah, I was writing up a post for it, but I never got to it.
That's weird, man.
Yeah, it's in the VR zone in Shinjuku in Japan.
Yeah, they've released some footage, and it's
from Namco.
Wild,
it's
man.
Developed like, by Namco Bandai.
It's crazy.
And I think it's on the Vive.
Yeah, I'm curious what headset they're going to be using, but it looks insane.
It looks kind of cool. Like, you throw turtle shells with your hands, and
yeah,
I couldn't tell if you actually drive or if it's on rails. That's what I couldn't tell. Looks like it.
I think you have to drive, because otherwise, what's the point?
Yeah, I guess.
So, sorry, I got a little sidetracked.
It looks cool, but we'll probably never get to play it.
You're probably right.
Unless magically there's VR places that start popping up here, but
I've seen a few of them like that. Heck, I saw one in Victoria when I was there 2 weekends ago.
That's true, but I feel like it's kind of like,
what do they call it? The VR zone or something like that downtown? I'm assuming you go in there and it's either Oculus's
HTC Vives. I've never actually been there, but I always see their ads on Facebook.
It's weird.
No, it looks cool, but I think it's one of those, like, it's a whole unit, probably like a lockdown system and some kind of proprietary shit going on for like an arcade style type setup.
Oh, I'm
sure it's not cheap.
Yeah, no, I'm
sure it's not like you're just downloading it on a Vive or Oculus and going at it.
Yeah.
It looks cool, though.
Yeah, it looks really interesting.
I lost my place. Okay. Oh, Logitech is acquiring Astro for $85 million cash money.
This is kind of a strange one for me.
They rolled up, popped the trunk, and it was just full of cash and a dead hooker. Like, I mean, just cash.
I'm kind of wondering, like, what was the point in this, really? Like Logitech has their own headset brand already. They make, you know, headsets and stuff, and that's what Astro does. They just make, like, headphones and whatnot.
Logitech is PC-centric, not console-centric. So I think they're just buying their foot in the door into the console marketplace. Also, the Astro headsets are a little more, I'd say, higher end than the Logitech stuff.
You think so?
Well, price point wise, they're like...
I feel like Logitech does a good job of having
I love my wireless 933 I use on my PC, and I actually use it with my Xbox and my PS4. Is an awesome headset. And it was, I think
is yours a USB one or no?
Yeah, it's USB. Like, it has a little dongle that goes in the USB. And anyway, it's an awesome headset. I think when it first came out, it was $200, but you can find it quite often around 120 now on sale. Probably like 100 in the US. It's a dope headset. It's got like the 7.1. Sounds great. Fold down.
Is it the virtual 7.1?
Yeah. Fold down.
Yeah, yeah.
Fold down microphone. Bunch of stupid buttons that do a bunch of shit you don't really care about.
It's super sounds like my Logitech headset.
It's super comfortable. Yeah, it's a sweet headset. I love it. But I've always been...
Is yours wireless?
Yeah, it's wireless.
Yeah.
I
think probably the wired version of that.
Yeah,
I got it for free from a buddy of mine.
I've always been allured by the A50s, though. They look so interesting. Cool. I like their little charging base. the only problem that I've had with the Astros is like they have that like mixer and you have to plug in a bunch of shit into it, and it didn't seem to like the nice thing about the Logitech one is there's a mini port, like a headphone jack on it.
Yeah.
So it comes with a cord that I could plug into my Xbox controller and or my PS4 controller, nice. And then it just works with my consoles, but it still works with my PC, and I actually can get my PC audio and my PS4 audio at the same time. Oh, so like I can be playing consoles while talking to the guys in Discord or whatever, and or listening to YouTube videos on my computer. So it works really well.
Okay.
I don't have an A50, so I could be talking out my ass. I feel like it's not easy. I think you could mix sources, but I don't feel like it's very fucking easy because it has that base. So my consoles are across the room from my PC, so without cords going all over the place. I imagine there's possibly a way of doing it, but it doesn't seem very convenient. Anyway, going on a tangent. I think the Astro headsets are pretty nice. And this is Logitech's foot into the console market. And
yeah, I guess that's true. I hadn't really thought about it that way. When I initially heard it, I was like, really? You're going to buy a headset manufacturer when you manufacture headsets? Like, why would you do that? But
still,
I guess you're right. A lot of Astro, I think my brother even has an Astro headset for his PS3 or PS4 stuff. So
still upset about that time. Totally unrelated subject. Well, it's kind of related. When I went to E3 in 2013 to Astro, and they're like, yeah, come visit us and get a free headset.
And you visited them, and they never
said anything. And they're like, we ran out of headsets. Just here, give us your business card, and we'll hook you up. Never got that headset.
Well, now they're getting sold to Logitech, and you can go talk to one of the Logitech people and be like, yo.
I don't need a free headset. But
hook a brother up.
They told me they were going to give me one, and they didn't. They're a bunch of liars.
Right.
I think it's cool. I like both those brands.
Yeah. Yeah, it's cool. I mean, obviously... You know, Astro is in a position where they needed to do something like that, so allows them to stick around for sure. So that's cool.
What's the next one? Dota 2. The International's coming up. I think a couple weeks.
That it is.
A month. Sometime in August. Is it August 12th?
I think it starts
August 7th,
and then the final is on August 12th.
Yeah, so we've talked about this before. It's the big giant It's basically the Super Bowl for Dota 2. Yep. They basically fill an arena. And this has made a lot of press over the years because the prize pools have just gotten more and more ridiculous. Right now, their prize pool is at 20.7 million and a bunch of other numbers, but I don't really feel like saying it. So they were already beat last year's by 20,000 at this point. And there's essentially still
the current prize pool as we speak right now at this very moment is $20,807,000. Oh, okay, so it's
even more.
Yeah.
So for those of you that don't know, that's basically fueled by the community buying in-game content. A percentage goes to Steam and another percentage goes towards the prize pool. And yeah, yeah, some fucking team of five little kids is going to be very rich.
It's crazy. That's... I mean, obviously, they're not going to get the whole prize pool because no, they have to split that up between first and second.
There's
and
teams all, you know, and agents yeah. and stuff that will take their cut, but just going to be a few young.
So
that's crazy.
25% of all battle pass sales go directly to the prize pool.
That's nuts. So the big winner is Steam.
Yeah, Valve fucking is rolling in
it. So 25%. So Steam's essentially made like almost $75 million off the Battle Pass is what we're saying.
If this thing hits $25 million, then we're looking at they've made $100 million.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's awesome. I think we talked about this in the past about DLC. Like we mentioned that they should do this for Street Fighter, and you said for
well, I mean that's what Smite, does.
Yeah, right?
Like that is what Smite does. They have their
like every game their should whole do thing. This because like, what is it like at Evo, which is coming up soon, the big fighting tournament in Vegas every year.
Yeah,
they. Their prize pools are like tens of thousands of dollars, but it's like, man, the game maker should make a here's this cosmetic suit, 50%, 25% goes to the Evo prize pool. And it's like, they might be surprised how big those prize pools get. And then you get stories, you get news, you get attention. And then, of course, they get 75% of the profits of a stupid cosmetic item they're selling.
Not only that, but it's such a way for it's just it's a great way for other people to want to play that game because there's money there, right? Like if you're going to get into competitive gaming, yeah, you obviously want to go someplace where money is.
You just get bigger. So that's exactly what's happened to Dota. Dota's gotten so crazy because of these stories.
Yep. And I mean, to put this into perspective, the 2017 Masters Golf Tournament had an $11 million prize pool.
Yeah, that's a worldwide popular sport.
That's huge, like, that's a professional ass sport.
That's existed for decades.
Yep. And it had $11 million
maybe
pool.
Maybe a century. I don't know how long golf, the PGA has been around, but man, it's been around for a while.
I'm amazed though. The Halo 5 Guardians World Championship gave out $1 million.
Yeah, that seems pretty sad.
It's crazy. I was on a site for one of our clients earlier this week, and I had a guy that I was working on a computer, and the guy beside me leans over to me and he's like, dude, he's like, you know, I saw the craziest thing this weekend. And I was like, okay, yeah. Like what's up? And he's like, I was watching, I don't remember what he was watching exactly, but he was like, and they were talking about that there's people that are out there and they're playing video games professionally and they're making like tons of money about it. And I mean, I'm assuming that it was probably a story about Dota.
Yeah, or YouTubers
and he
or something.
Was asking me about like if I'd heard about this, which of course I had,
of course,
because I'm a giant nerd, and which of course got us into talking. But he was fascinated. You know, he enjoyed sports. He was kind of a sports guy. He liked hockey and he liked that. But he when he heard that like some of these games had this type of esports thing going on, and there was this kind of money, and that there was teams, and it was like, we're talking serious. He was like actually asking me like, oh, if I've ever watched it, and like he was really curious about it, and I thought it was really interesting. Here is somebody who doesn't really play any video games, who, you know, he used to play games like long time ago, you know, when he was younger and stuff, but like here he was getting interested in video games because he saw some shit on TV about esports and was like super curious how he could like watch some of this on if he had to, like if he could watch it on TV or if he had to watch it on the internet and if he had to pay for it. Like, he was really curious about it.
It's really fascinating. Like, esports is like in its infancy. Like, as big as it seems it is still a tiny blip on the radar for mainstream culture.
Yeah. Oh no, absolutely. You know, so we were talking and I was like, oh, you can, you know, usually catch tournaments on like Twitch and, you know, depending on like what games you want to watch. And he's like, you mean, and he couldn't believe it. There was like all these different games that had tournaments and that this was, and I was telling him, you know, like esports is a thing.
Did you tell him the even more amazing fact that like professional gamers like retire in their low 20s, mid 20s because they're considered too old?
No, I didn't. Should have blown his mind with that fact. Yeah, most people retire before they're 25 because their reflexes are starting to go.
I'm pretty sure they still have to find another freaking outlet or another job, but like they retire from pro video gaming. This really lends well to the next story that I got here. So, speaking of esports, Blizzard announced the first Overwatch League teams and owners. And if we talked about this, man, I feel like this is easily over a year ago when we talked about...
Well, they announced this thing a while ago.
Yeah, right? Like, when they were talking that they were building, we want to make esports, but we want to make it based around cities so that people can have something like, you know, what is it? Fucking team solo mid and team fuckity fuck and all these weird teams that have no like affiliation. It's like, if you don't know the players, it's kind of hard to get invested or excited about cheering for a certain team without being...
Especially when a lot of these teams are changing names. This team, Nighthawk, turned into team SMG. And, oh, yeah,
for sure. Cloud9. What's Cloud9 mean? Cloud9's just... We went and cherry-picked these players from all over the world. We don't have a real identity. Of course... These city-based teams are just going to get players from all over the world as well, but...
That's no different than every other sports
team. Yeah, exactly.
Team,
like, American teams win the Stanley Cup every year, but it's all Canadian players.
I don't know about all, but there's quite a few of them. Yeah.
So, anyway, Overwatch announced this a year ago. We talked about it. I said, this is fucking cool, because if I can cheer for Vancouver or Seattle or whatever, that's fucking cool. I can get behind cheering behind a team that I feel like is my team, as opposed to... I don't know who the fuck any of these guys are. Like, let's be honest, only the most hardcore esports fans, and there's tons of them, don't get me wrong, actually know who these players are. But the rest of us out here, it doesn't, like your friend at work, it doesn't exist to them, right?
No.
So this is Blizzard trying to basically bridge that gap and help esports become the mainstream thing that it essentially kind of deserves to be, because it's really fucking cool.
So just, I don't know if Overwatch is going to be the game to do it, but I think it's a neat idea.
The system they're coming up with, I think, is the even more important thing here. And just to give you an idea how big a play this is, we're talking about the first seven cities, but more importantly are the people involved. So Robert Kraft, the owner of the New England Patriots, he owns the rights for the Boston team. Jeff Wilpon, I don't know if that's how you pronounce it, chairman, CEO of the New York Mets, is fielding the New York franchise. And there's a couple other guys here from other like esports teams and stuff. Mainly, but we've got New York, Boston, Los Angeles, San Francisco, Orlando,
And then actually a couple from Asia, actually, Shanghai and South Korea and Seoul,
which is pretty freaking cool. You know, there's a lot of discussion about how Blizzard was like asking a shitload of money and all this stuff about revenue sharing and blah, 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 blah. It just kind of seemed, I don't know, that was a whole different story that came out. They're like, oh, they want $20 million per team. But I think this was like the teams like Cloud9 and Fnatic and these other teams that are, they don't have the clout to, I think, pay up for that. And that was kind of their throwing a tantrum like, oh, we want to be part of this league. Why can't we? We exist in esports already, right? But Blizzard's kind of going for a different thing. It's like, no, this is like professional to another level. This is like NHL, NBA. We were doing something different here.
And yeah, I mean,
I think a lot of teams whining about the buy-in were just kind of like, they just figured they should be able to get in because...
Yeah.
But the problem with a lot of the esports scene right now that kind of gets talked about, doesn't get talked about, a lot of these existing esports teams screw their players out of money, or they don't pay them, or there's all kinds of other advantages they're taking. You know, this whole Blizzard thing is probably going to create like an industry for proper agents for these players, proper benefits for these players, less of these stories of these guys won this Counter-Strike GO tournament and they didn't get their money. And
well, this is interesting because the Overwatch League is going to kick off and they're actually going to be happening in venues like a regular sports team will. So like for the league's first season, matches are going to take place currently at a venue in the Los Angeles area as the local squads take the time they need to build their own local venues. But eventually, there will be away and home matchups, just like in traditional sports. Full details on the schedule, et cetera, et cetera, are going to be announced
home
later.
Home games, selling tickets, merchandise, and all.
But like, this is the thing. It's interesting. They're going to make money through ticket sales, advertising, and broadcast rights revenue, similar to what the NBA or the NHL or the NFL does. So then, according to Blizzard, this money is going to get shared evenly
between all the local teams.
Get to keep all of the revenue from their home territory and venue up to a certain amount. If or when this figure is eclipsed, a percentage will be given to a shared league revenue pool. So another element here is that franchises can operate and make money from 5 non-professional events in their home region every year as well.
Pretty cool, man. I could see myself buying some of these fucking jerseys.
So then the other thing that's a neat thing that they're doing, there's going to be league and team-based Overwatch content sold in the game, and 50% of that revenue is going to a shared revenue pool for all of the teams. So that's kind of cool, because I was going to ask, like, you know, like, to me that doesn't seem like that would be a lot of money, especially, like, initially here, but the fact that they could kind of pull in revenue in the game as well, that's a smart move, I think.
Yeah. This is more than, like, this is the Overwatch League, but this is really Activision's big play into setting up a general profession, like a really organized professional, not mishmash 20 different scenes. Like, this is the professional esports league, you know? Like,
well,
I bet you these teams are going to have, you know, whatever, when there's a Call of Duty platform, or who knows, maybe they'll have a, who knows, this could move into a CSGO thing. This could move into a Dota thing. I know those guys do their own thing, but
that's the real question. The other, I think, real question that I was going to say about this is that this is a really cool thing and it's a really good idea. And it seems like, you know, you're building upon a great thing. But let's be honest, like, video games tend to not have a huge, like, obviously, you know, League of Legends over the last while has grown into this huge thing. But look at, you know, StarCraft, the original StarCraft at one point was massive in South Korea. Everybody was playing it. It was a phenomenon. It was on TVs. There was multiple channels, and like, now, yes, it's still played, but it is definitely not anywhere even close to what it was. Now, that's kind of the only Achilles heel of this whole system that they've got right now, is that this is the Overwatch League. Like, are people still going to even be playing Overwatch in 5 years to the extent that this makes sense, you know? Or are they going to try and build this as, like you said, an esports league? Because I think that is actually the biggest challenge with esports, is that people move to and from games. Like, football has essentially not changed fundamentally in 100 years or more. Basketball, same thing. Like, there's obviously there's little tweaks here and there to the game and like rules and things like that, but ultimately, fundamentally, that game is still basketball, same as it was now, same as it was 20 years ago, same as it was 30 years ago. And same with like all of that. That is the one big thing that the big sports that people watch and that they love and they fall in love with all have in common. And that's the one thing that esports kind of doesn't have. You know, are people going to get tired of watching or even playing League of Legends? Are they, or is League of Legends continue to is it going to continue to grow? I don't know. Mm-hmm. You know, as like, that's kind of the difference with esports over these other ones. And I don't know what that means if you're going to try and create like a league like they're trying to do here. You know, is the Overwatch League going to be a really cool experiment that's going to last for a couple of seasons before not enough people are still playing Overwatch to make anybody care? Like, or are they going to hopefully build upon it? And
this is the game that launches, but this is not, like I said, I think this is a bigger play in creating the professional esports league in general. The game will probably be evolving and changing, but this is creating the NHL, NFL, MLS version of esports. As opposed to like it is now, the total silos of Dota and League of Legends and so forth, right? That haven't, that they're huge in their own right, but still haven't managed to crack that mainstream. Because when they do, man, whoever opens that door, oh God, that's just
gonna it's going to be crazy. That's
a
for
lot
sure.
of, that's a lot of money there. That's a lot of freaking money. So it's cool. I think it's cool. I can't wait to freaking own a fucking jersey to a city-based team.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's really, really interesting.
It's cool. Like, it's in its infancy.
Just because of the way like the various games work and stuff, like obviously this is being set up by Blizzard and Activision. And
yeah, like, you know that, there's going to be a
kind of the challenge, right?
You know, there's going to be like, a Call of Duty league.
Well, there already is,
but like a more organized, bigger version, like
with like are all of these teams the now going to field a Call of Duty team?
Who knows? Like probably they get first option on that kind of stuff, right?
Because like I don't know if you remember, probably what 5-6 years ago, somebody tried to create a National Gaming League NGL. And they tried to do it in a very similar way to this.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure they didn't
have the
same.
Or Major League Gaming, sorry. It was MLG, Major League Gaming.
Pretty sure they didn't have the same amount of money in pull and sway as Activision.
Well, no. But the way that they did it was very similar to this. They had teams across... like, what they did is they had teams in cities, like we're talking about right now. They also had... what they did is they did a... various games. So they chose Counter-Strike, StarCraft 2, and whatever else the games were. There was a fighting game in there and a racing game. And then I think Halo was another one of them. And the idea was is that they would then have a pool of players in those various games. And they did a draft, like a professional team, like a professional sports teams do. So they had drafts. And they would draft the players that they would try and get for their specific rosters for their teams. And then that was the idea, was that they would then play away games. Very, like I said, very similar to this, but not tied to one game. A lot more of kind of like what you were talking about with kind of a more games.
Yeah.
And like, I don't know if it was a little too early.
Probably too early.
For that to really kind of take off. But I mean, at one point, I remember turning on my television and watching a Halo match from an MLG game happening down in California at, you know, wherever they were playing it, being aired on, you know, our version of ESPN, which was like TSN or whatever at the time. And I was like, wow, this is kind of cool.
With the exception of League of Legends and Dota 2, like they've succeeded in what they want to do. But everyone's been going after the Golden Goose esports, right? Like, esports, like fucking,
so,
you know, like Evolve and all these games. This is esports. It's the fucking term that everyone throws around because they're hoping their game becomes the next League of Legends and Dota, essentially, right?
Yeah, I mean, I just actually pulled up the MLG site because I was curious if they were still around or not, and they totally are.
They're totally around. But
So like, they're on board with the Call of Duty. So they're the guys that are attached to Call of Duty, and they're playing the Call of Duty World League is attached to MLG. But MLG does it in, like, they definitely do it in a different way, because they're still utilizing Cloud9 and Solo Mid and like all of those types of teams and players and stuff like that, right? And it looks like right now they're playing predominantly Call of Duty, Destiny, Gears of War, and Overwatch are like the big ones that people are playing with them. It's interesting. I'm just kind of looking at it like right now, and I mean, we've got the big one that's coming up is the Call of Duty World Championship that happens in August in Florida, right? And it's all through them. So it's interesting because obviously, as we just talked about, Activision owns Call of Duty, and they've kind of been attached to this other league this whole time, right? With that stuff. So it'll be curious to see sort of how that affects all of this moving forward, if they move that to the more... See, and I think that's... I think maybe naming it the Overwatch League was kind of a bad idea. I don't know.
Well, I don't know.
Because you've kind of locked yourself into...
This is the Overwatch League, but I'm the way this smells, I see bigger picture here.
Yeah, no, I'm not disagreeing with you.
I think that's it for news, my friend.
Yeah.
We can get into some PSAs. There's a few this week. Remember that Splatoon demo?
Right.
Comes out. You can pre-download it. We talked about it last week. If you haven't already pre-downloaded it and you want to get a taste of Splatoon on Saturday between the ridiculous time of 3 and 7 p.m.,
Pacific time,
July 15th. You've got that little window to play some Splatoon 2, some Splatfest. It's
fucking stupid. It's like the worst time for me. Like,
I don't understand why Nintendo just doesn't do beta weekends like everyone else. Like, Jesus Christ.
It's because they don't have enough users on the platform to not push their server load all weekend, so they need to try and put them all into an area to stress it.
I just don't think they want to give away the big free hit. Someone can get their fill of 3 days of playing a beta and never come back.
Yeah.
Destiny 2 beta starts next week. Pretty sure it starts on Tuesday for pre-orders on PS4. And then I think it's a day or 2 days that they get exclusivity, then Xbox, and then next weekend, the 21st, is the open beta. And this is for Xbox One and PS4 PCs in August. We talked about that. So we're talking next week, we will most likely both have played Destiny, I assume. Maybe. Not. Yes.
I will have definitely played
the beta, so not that
one of us will definitely have played the beta.
Not that anyone needs a reminder, but Game of Thrones season 7 premieres this weekend. That's been a while. Can't wait. Oh my god.
A better thing that we've probably forgot to talk about is the fact that Preacher season 2 is fucking happening right now. If you are not watching that, you should get in on it, because it is freaking awesome.
3 episodes into that?
Yeah.
Man, that show's fucked up.
That show is fucking awesome.
That show's really messed up.
And awesome.
It's really messed up.
And awesome.
It's pretty good. My wife can't watch it though. She's like, yeah, I'm done. I can't watch this. Cause it's super violent.
It's dark.
Oh,
it's humor dark. Is dark. It's super,
it's fucked up, twisted, and it's super gory violent. She's like, yeah, I'm done. This is too much.
And yet you guys watch The Walking Dead.
Yeah, but it's different.
Is it?
It's, yeah, whatever. Shut up.
Look.
Yeah, I'm enjoying
Preacher. Preacher's not for everyone, all right?
We like season
2. That shit is great.
We both like
that
season
1.
That
show is amazing.
And yeah, season 2 is...
My wife loves it.
Season 2 is off to a bananas start.
Yes.
Like, it's just freaking crazy.
So, yeah.
There's a really good Game of Thrones season 6 recap episode from GameSpot. GameSpot of Thrones. Mm. I linked it on Twitter this... earlier today, but it'll be in the podcast show notes. So if you look in the info page in your podcast player, if you click on the Game of Thrones season 7, that'll take you to that recap season 6 video. It's pretty cool. I was like, oh yeah, that did fucking happen. I forgot about that. It's a really good video. It's short. I think it's like 8 minutes or something, 10 minutes maybe. It's really awesome.
That's cool.
Yeah, check it out if you want to just a refresher. First going into season 7, which I think is excellent. And then, yeah, I guess we're in our free for all. I saw Spider-Man and you saw Transformers.
Nice. Very nice.
I'm going to let you go first because I don't want to end the show on a bummer. So you can talk about Transformers first and then I'll talk about Spider-Man.
Wow, you don't have a whole lot of
no, I don't have a whole lot of faith. I don't have a lot of faith. I listened to some reviews. I hear it.
I liked it a lot.
I heard it's the best Bayformers, but at this point, you're just sick of Bayformers.
The way I look at it, the first one that he did. It was new. It was exciting. It was like, holy shit. It was the first time.
This is number 5.
That anybody had actually attempted to do. And it was a semblance of something that you wanted. And it was the first time you got to see giant alien robots beat the shit out of each other. And it was great. But that being said, none of them were going to win any Oscars for anything like that. Like, it's a freaking... giant alien robots beating the snot out of each other and other people being involved.
And explosions. Kind of, and
yeah, and big explosions.
Taking like, the thing from point... taking the payload from point A to point B.
Pretty much.
The first three movies essentially were fucking that same story. I think even the fourth one, they had to get something from somewhere to somewhere.
This is not... they got to find something and then get it from somewhere to somewhere else.
Yeah,
like,
it's just ridiculous. It's like...
the thing is like, I still enjoyed it. I thought it was great. It was a big, ridiculous popcorn movie. Is it going to win any Oscars? Absolutely not. I guess at this point, it was one of those things where I watched it, I enjoyed it, but it wasn't like I went, oh my God, that was amazing. Holy crap. That was so cool.
I want to see it out of curiosity because I'm a Transformers fan, but
yeah, exactly.
Every time I see these movies, it's like, God damn it, why couldn't have, like,
I don't,
someone else had the license, but with the same budget and effects?
Budget.
And, like,
yeah. Like, yeah, I don't know. Like I said, I'm mixed on it because I enjoy them.
Yeah, it's not a steaming pile of shit. They're watchable.
No, well, and I mean, hey, some people hate them. I get it. Like some people hate them. Like they are just like, oh my God, you've destroyed my childhood. Blah 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 blah. Whatever.
I'm kind of on that fence.
I'm not. I enjoy them. They're fine. I'm at the point now where I maybe wouldn't mind if they decided to like reboot them and go with like,
you know what,
maybe a little bit closer to Gen 1.
They're like,
and I don't know.
To me, they're like, if it's on TV, I'll watch it. But at the same time, I just like the whole time I'm like, man, I really wish this was done by someone else. Like, they're not so bad that I'll just stop watching, but I'm not.
You know, it's kind of sad because, like, so many of Michael Bay's other films, I've loved all. Yeah, like lot.
Bad Boys 2 is a fantastic movie.
Bad Boys 1 is one of my favorite movies of all time.
Like, I love
the way that he filmed it. Like, it is, there is so many.
The guy knows how to film movies and make movies, but I just, the whole Transformers franchise as a hardcore Transformers fan, to me, is just so offensive. Cause it's like, he barely respects the source material. They're his aliens, his Transformers, his Decepticons. They're alien and they're foreign and this and that, and they're just so fucking over-designed. They're so fucking noisy. Half the time, you can't even see the details on the fucking robots because there's just so many fucking angles and lines and bullshit. They're over-designed, and that's what kills me. But like you said, like, I can enjoy it, but at the same time, it's like, fuck, man.
Yeah.
Why couldn't, like, just any other director, like, freaking...
See, and I actually disagree on the other director thing. I actually think that chances are if another director might have got their hands on it, it maybe wouldn't, that we may have gotten one and then it may have essentially killed the whole franchise and that might have been the end of that.
Well, they know what they know what they wanted when they went with Michael Bay. It's going to be explosion, like you said, popcorn flick. It's going to make millions of dollars regardless of being good or bad. And that's what they've been doing for five movies now. And it makes money, so it keeps going. But yeah, fuck, please reboot it. God damn it.
I
want it to be Star Wars. But it's not. It's just, yeah. It's there making millions of dollars.
Here's the thing though. And I say this out of love, and I say this as a Transformers fan. Go back and watch the cartoon.
Oh, I'm not
dude.
Saying
it doesn't
I'm not saying
fucking hold up.
I'm
like,
not
there
saying
is not. You go back and watch it now, and you're going, like,
I'm not saying the cartoons are good.
As far as source material goes, like, this is the thing. Like, everybody is like, oh man, the source material. And, like,
but no, the
again,
comics,
like, I
are
love
amazing.
The cartoons. They are what they are.
The comics are amazing.
Yes.
There's a world of lore and character that
totally
can be totally delved into.
But ignore
the
thing is, a lot of Transformers fans have never read any of the comics. They're just a fan of the original cartoon, and they have this fantasy reverence for the cartoon when they were kids or when they were younger and they watched them and they were great. But the thing is if you go back and you watch them now, and like, I own all the seasons on DVD or whatever.
80s cartoon after school schlock, it's like G.I. Joe and everything else.
It doesn't hold up very well at all.
But
you know, and so when people say
it's not gonna hold up,
go back to the source material, it's a little bit like, yes, I don't disagree with that statement, but at the same time, you have to give them some sort of freedom to run with it and make it so that it doesn't.
He's just taking too many freedoms is the problem.
Yeah, and I think at this point, like, they're starting to get into, it's a different thing, and I think that you have to just realize that there's the Michael Bay Transformers universe, and it's got nothing to do with the other universes, kind of like we do with all the other, you know, comic book universes and stuff like that, right?
Yeah.
They live within their own universe, and they're making different things with, you know, who Unicron is and who Trans Optimus Prime is and who the Primes were.
I'll probably watch it. I don't know if I'll watch it in the theater, though. I'll definitely watch it when it comes home.
Yeah. It was a situation where I wanted to go see Spider-Man. The person I was with kind of did, but kind of didn't. And then we went to the theater and, like, Spider-Man was pretty busy. And so it just kind of was like,
I probably would have seen Transformers by now, but my wife has no interest in seeing it.
Yeah.
So we went and saw Spider-Man.
I've heard good things.
Now let's talk about an awesome universe and an awesome respect for everything that has come before. Oh my God. What an amazing movie.
Yeah, I've
I think it's better than Guardians 2. I think it's
yeah, that's fair.
I think it's shot up to my top five movies. I don't have like a particular placement. It is hands down the best Spider-Man movie ever. You can erase all of the other schlock that has come before this. And I don't know why I keep saying schlock. I like that word tonight for some reason. He is
not only... How did you feel about
the Andrew
Garfield ones?
What's that?
How did you feel about the Andrew Garfield Spider-Man?
They were fine. I didn't hate them. I felt like they were going in a good direction compared to where number three left off. But one and two...
I really liked the first one. The second one, unfortunately,
one
got way too far up its own ass.
And two, the Sam Raimi ones, were fantastic movies.
Two, especially.
Oh, two is amazing.
Yeah.
This movie makes those movies look like fucking utter trash. This movie is awesome. Just, it's almost like
Deadpool level awesome.
No, like even better than Deadpool. It is a fantastic movie. It is one of the best comic book movies, period. That I've seen.
Better than Deadpool.
I did not expect it to be this good. That's the thing. I was like, oh, Homecoming. Yeah, he was cool and fucking his little appearance in Civil War.
Right.
But man, I don't even know Spider-Man. I know Spider-Man, but I don't know Spider-Man. Like, I think the comic book character I know the most and identify with the most is Iron Man and then the Punisher. Because I read those ones when I was younger.
Right.
You
didn't watch the Spider-Man cartoon growing up?
I watched the Spider-Man cartoon, but the Spider-Man cartoon is like 60s Batman. Like,
No, I'm talking about the one in the 90s.
No, I don't think I was watching cartoons at that point. I was chasing girls.
Oh, okay. Because, yeah, around 90, I think it was 94 to 96, they did. Right around the same time as the Batman animated series.
Well, see, I did watch the Batman, but I never watched the Spider-Man.
Interesting, yeah. Because there was the Batman one, and then the Spider-Man one came out right around the same time, as well as the X-Men one as well.
It's a fun freaking movie, man. It's a funny movie. It's a fun movie. There's some really cool twist. Like, there's a really cool twist that you don't see coming. The setup for the whole villain and plot line in this movie is done really well. The high school life they show for Spider-Man is really fun. Like, everyone can relate to that.
He's actually in fucking high school, and he doesn't seem like he's a college-age student pretending to be in high school.
He's so human. He's so relatable. And it just has that funness of, like, if I was a superhero, like, you know what I mean? Like, do you remember the origin story in the first Spider-Man when he got his powers and he was just fucking around? And that was a very memorable scene, like, doing all this fun shit. There's a lot of that in this movie.
Yeah.
And it's just...
The fact that he doesn't... the fact that he doesn't just shoot fucking spider webbing out of his arm, it's already winning above the Sam Raimi ones.
Yeah, it's the web fluid and the canisters and the freaking his suit that he gets from Tony is freaking amazing. It's a freaking good movie.
That's awesome.
The best Spider-Man movie, and it's
I want to watch it real bad.
It's one of the best comic book movies. When I heard that people had said this movie was good, I was like, yeah, compared to the last stuff, I was expecting it to just be okay, you know, not like a burning trash pile, but crap, man. They really
Spider-Man's always been one of my favorite.
I don't know,
like,
how Marvel,
if not my favorite comic book character.
Yeah, you're gonna freaking love this movie. Oh my god, like, yeah, trust me, you're going to like this movie. I just don't understand how Marvel just keeps knocking these out of the park. Like, I don't understand. Like, talk about...
They have people...
Yeah, it's the Disney
from
money.
Marvel that are fucking involved in the making of these movies, going like, okay, no, we're not going to do that because that's not fucking Spider-Man, and we're going to instead do this... You know what I mean?
And we're like, they have the people best people that for are in every step place. Of the way, and we're not going to
exactly.
We're not going to make sure any that, punches. Like,
yeah, and that's a huge part of it. You know, like you instead think? Of like even the Sam Raimi ones from back then, they essentially outsourced that to a studio. They said like, "Hey, we want to work with you." The studio says, "Okay, cool. We're going to come in. We're going to make this movie. You're going to, you know, we're going to ask you some questions, but ultimately we're going to make this movie." And they went, "Okay, cool." And like, they got a lot of it right, but they got a lot of it wrong at the same time, you know, and that's unfortunately how the first couple of those Marvel movies went.
Yeah. Well, you know, like the first Spider-Man, the Sony shit that, which is a whole,
well, yeah, like, Spider-Man was, you know, only Sony did buy the rights to Spider-Man and they got a smoking deal on them.
Yeah.
But they did this, they did a similar thing with the Hulk, right? Where with the, was it the Dave Aang film where it was this weird, bizarre, what the heck kind of movie is this? And a lot of people were super disappointed and it was a bizarre kind of movie. And then, you know, and then of course, they remade, you know that we all kind of forget that that movie exists, and you know, with Eric Bana playing the Hulk and stuff like that, and we all sort of try to forget that that movie was a thing. And then they made The Incredible Hulk, which was a great movie and was so much better, and that was actually sort of the beginnings of the MCU. That came out even before I'm trying to remember. It either came out before Iron or right Man. Around the same time as Iron Man. Like, they were...
Yeah, it's... Iron Man, you know, essentially was the launching for the MCU. 2008? Mm-hmm. That's almost 10 years now. You think we'd have freaking super... Well, some people do have superhero fatigue now, but I... Until they start making bad movies, I don't see myself getting sick of these yet, because they're just so much freaking fun. And they're enjoyable.
Yeah, I don't see myself. I mean, obviously, I am a giant nerd, so for me, it's great. I'm loving this, but
yeah, the
you know,
nerds.
I definitely do know that there are some people out there that are feeling a little bit fatigued, right?
The nerds have truly taken over.
Yeah. Yeah, so I don't know, So The Incredible Hulk premiered in June of 2008. Was that before or
that
after
was,
Iron
they
Man?
Came out right around the same time.
Yeah.
But it wasn't, I know they but were, it wasn't part of the MCU.
No, it was. Absolutely was.
Was it?
Yep.
Really?
They actually had Sam, oh, what's his name? Comes in at the very end and tries to sort of like recruit him. Edward Norton was supposed to reprise the role in the Avengers, but
he's an idiot and fucked up.
Yeah, he didn't want to be involved in it, but yeah, it was absolutely part of the MCU.
You think he's kicking himself over that decision nowadays?
He's Edward Norton. He's a little bit of a weird dude.
Yeah, but still, fuck that.
Yeah,
I wouldn't be very happy about missing out on that MCU money.
Yeah, because at the end, the very final end scene of
that
film,
I remember liking that movie. That was
Iron Man coming into talking to the general at a local bar and talking to him about a team that he's putting together.
Hmm.
It's definitely part of the MCU.
I liked the Hulk movie with Edward Norton. Yeah. I didn't love it, but I liked it.
No, it was a good movie.
But that's
though.
The last Hulk movie. Like, there hasn't actually been a Hulk movie since then.
No. There's rumor that it might get a new one, though.
Yeah, he's tough because he's a primarily CG character, and it's not like we would like to watch that, but mainstream viewers might not be so interested in that.
Actually, it's got a lot more to do with just reading here that apparently Marvel reacquired the film rights for the character, but Universal retained the distribution rights for The Incredible Hulk, as well as the right of first refusal to distribute future Hulk films.
Mm.
So a potential reason why Marvel has not reacquired the film distribution rights as they did with the Paramount Pictures for Iron Man, Thor, and the Captain America is because Universal holds the theme park rights to several of the Marvel characters that Marvel parent company Disney wants for its own stuff, theme parks. So apparently that strained the relationship between Marvel and Universal. Maybe another obstacle in getting the standalone Hulk film rights happening.
Hmm.
So we'll see. Yeah.
That'd be cool if Disney got the rights back to make Marvel Land. I'm pretty sure they're working their freaking asses off on that.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I'm like
positive they're working on it.
Well, that's the thing, though, is like if Universal has those rights on lockdown,
man, Marvel made
like
some
how
really
X-Men does.
Marvel made some really stupid fucking decisions when they almost went out of business.
Dude, they were in like the mode where we're gonna go bankrupt if we don't do.
Yeah,
some
we
shit.
Need to fucking sell a kidney. Get in here.
Yeah,
take both. We don't need them.
Because right now at Universal Studios. There is an island.
Oh, I've been there. Fantasy Island or whatever it's called.
Marvel,
yeah,
it's called
Spiderman
Marvel Superhero
Ride,
Island.
Hulk Ride. They're fucking awesome rides, too. They're sweet.
Yep.
Basically, the Transformers ride is like a new version of what the Spiderman ride is. And the Hulk ride is just a fantastic roller coaster.
Yeah, and apparently, like, currently... Universal has come out and said that our agreement with Marvel stands for as long as we follow the terms of our existing contract and for as long as we want there to be a Marvel Superhero Island. So it sounds like that is not exactly a
I don't see that lasting forever. You heard it here first.
Well, I'm sure it's not gonna last forever, but right now, Universal would be stupid to get rid of it.
Yeah, well,
or change
they don't
that.
Want to. Dane, my friend, I'm going to say that's a show.
That's a show, man.
Go watch Spider-Man and play some PUBG.
I'm going to watch Spider-Man, but I'll probably play some Secret World Legends.
Thanks, everyone, for listening. You can follow me on Twitter at Rick F. No K R I C F.
You can always come hang out on Twitter with me at Dane Cody, at DaneCody.
Make sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, subscribe to us on YouTube. It's Geekoholics everywhere. And of course, the most important bit, review us on iTunes if you have the ability to. It helps us get more listeners and or review us anywhere where podcasts are listed. Hey, man, if you know where podcasts are rated, reviewed, and listed, let me know. If we're not there, I need to get there. I think we're available everywhere. Well, our RS feed is
pretty much
playable in any podcast player. So, but who knows? Maybe there's a deep, dark hole on the internet we haven't penetrated. Until next week, I'm going to say we're out.
Later.
Peace.